If there's one thing that always draws us back to the cross, it's the Lamb of God. And we recognize that it was there where he was sacrificed for our sin. Good morning. Great to be here, isn't it? Great to sing these songs and great to be among these people. This is truly the greatest place we could be this morning. If you came in after Brian got started, you may have missed the announcements about the restrooms. There are no functioning restrooms in this building this morning. So if you're drinking coffee or tea, go lightly. It's just as soon as I said that, Mike Bowen took a drink. Perfect timing, brother. Go lightly. There are restrooms over at his house, which is right straight across the parking lot. And so if you need to use the restroom, there are two of them over there, and you can use those. If you would like for somebody to drive you over there so you don't have to walk across the parking lot, just flag somebody down, get a hold of Mark or Wirt or somebody. There's people outside, and they'll be glad to do that for you. This is a good time to be a part of the church here. I say that right after the announcements about the restrooms. But it really is. There's so much going on, and in this time of year, we get so active, and so many things begin to take place. Next Saturday, I hear that there's a retreat for the ladies. Is that right? Strive is next weekend. And so, ladies, hopefully you're planning on being a part of that, and that happens next Saturday. I would like to invite the teens and their parents to a luncheon next Sunday following our worship assembly, just to talk about our mission trip for next year and to see where we want our kids to go and kind of talk about that and some different opportunities that are available to us. So if you're able to be here for that, that's a great time. If you know of parents and teens that are not here, spread the word. Share the word so that they can be part of what we're doing here. There's a whole lot going on, and it's just a great time to be part of the church here in Corona. Let's pray together as we enter into God's word. Father, we bow before you to recognize, first of all, your holiness, to see your majesty, to understand your power in creation and in salvation. And so we thank you for revealing yourself to us through your word. We thank you for this book we call the Bible and for its power, your power within these words to lead us in a life of godliness, to lead us into righteousness, to lead us into salvation. And so we praise you for this book and ask your blessings on our study. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Well, turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. We're going to take a look at verses 18 through 22, and we're going to spend some time looking at this Lamb of God that we have just sung about. This Lamb of God who was crucified, who was killed in a mockery of justice, a humiliating death, not for anything that he did, but because for everything that we've done. And so beginning in verse 18, Peter says, "For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also went and made proclamation to the spirits now in prison, who once were disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah during the construction of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you also, not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven after angels and authorities and powers had been subjected to him. One of the things that we've been learning from Peter's letter is that really it's a letter of Christian ethics. It's a letter about doing what is right. Not necessarily what would be best for me, what would be easiest for me, what would alleviate a lot of my hardships and suffering, but doing what is right. Regardless of the consequences, regardless of the opposition, regardless of the sacrifice that's involved for me, but doing what is right because God says that it's right. And Jesus provides us the greatest example of all. Jesus is the one who was doing what is right. And so throughout this letter, we've seen that we're supposed to be doing what is right in our families, right? We're supposed to be doing right in our businesses and in our relationships. We're supposed to be doing right with our faith, doing what is right toward God. And it's all based upon who Jesus is. It's based upon what Jesus has done and on what Jesus asks of us. That's what doing what is right is all about. Who is Jesus? What has he done? And what does he ask of us? And doing what is right is dependent upon those three things. Jesus always did what was right, no matter the cost, no matter the sacrifice, no matter the suffering. He always did what was right. Even when some people had different expectations for him, Jesus did what was right. When some wanted to take him by force and make him king, he could have alleviated the cross altogether. The shame, the mockery, the trial, and all of the suffering that led to the cross, the beating, the scourging, the crown of thorns, all of that, the spitting, the slapping, all of that stuff could have been avoided if he had tried to meet people's expectations. But he wasn't concerned about people's expectations. He could have avoided hardship. That's what makes Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8 so special. It tells us to have this attitude in ourselves that was also in Christ Jesus, who did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself. And he took the form of a servant. And he humbled himself to the point of death, even the death of the cross. When the customs and traditions of his day dictated otherwise, when people were so bent on observing the law of Moses and even as incorrectly as it was applied in Jesus' day, he went against all of those traditions. It was Jesus who would confront the traditions that were within the temple where people were buying and selling, and he would go in and make a whip out of cords and start throwing tables around and shooing the animals out of the temple and saying, "My house is to be a house of prayer." When the customs and the traditions of the people of his day differed, Jesus still did what was right. And so Peter gives us, really, it's the second of Jesus' examples to follow. Chapter 2, verse 21 through 25 also gives us the example. But here, it's the example as Jesus as the Lamb of God. That's how Jesus was introduced to the world. You remember when John was baptizing at the Jordan River and he saw Jesus approaching and he told everybody to look up there. I want you to see that guy. In fact, he uses the word behold, which is a powerful word in the Bible. It means a whole lot more than just see it. It means understand the meaning, understand who that is. Don't just see a person, but you need to behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's how John introduced Jesus in the first place. He'll also say the same thing in John chapter 1, verse 36. It's this Jesus who was tempted by the devil in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11, where the devil, or the Holy Spirit, took him out into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And the devil offered him three opportunities to avoid the cross. He said, "Why don't you take these stones and turn them into bread?" And Jesus says, "It is written." And he says, "Well, I tell you what. Let me take you up on the pinnacle of the temple, and we'll look out over all these lands." And he says, "You can have them all. You can reign over all of these lands. You just join with me." And Jesus said, "It is written." And then the devil said, "Well, why don't you just bow down and worship me?" And Jesus says, "It is written." And so even amidst the greatest temptation, Jesus did what was right. He was the Lamb of God. If he had caved into any of these temptations, and then the text tells us that the devil left him until a more opportune time. If Jesus had caved at any temptation that he ever faced, he would no longer be qualified to be the Lamb of God. He would be sinful rather than sinless. And the Lamb, to be sacrificed for sin, had to be spotless and without blemish. And that was the Lamb that was offered by the Father. It's interesting that God had asked another father to sacrifice his son. When Abraham was asked to sacrifice Isaac, and Abraham was willing, and he did everything that he was told to do. He even put his son on the altar. And he even raised a knife until he was told to stop. God put his son on an altar. Looked like a cross. Nothing fancy about it. Nothing fancy like the altars that are used today. It was a cross. And it was there where a hammer was raised. And God didn't stop it. And the nail was pounded through the hands and the feet. As he hung there, a sword was thrust into his side. And he was offered by the Father. God offered what we could not offer. That spotless Lamb. Oh, Lamb of God. How I love that Lamb of God. Look at the Lamb's death. The way Jesus describes that, or the way Peter describes it. He says, Christ died for sins, the just for the unjust. He died once for all. There's three things that we can learn from that. That first of all, that the death that the Lamb died was undeserved. It was the just for the unjust. Paul would tell the Romans that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we deserved all of the punishment that Jesus was taking, Jesus took it anyway. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Secondly, he says it was unrepeatable. It was once for all. It was a sacrifice that had never been made before. The Hebrew writer describes to us how people of Old Testament times would make sacrifices day after day, year after year. The same sacrifices that could never take away sin. They atoned for sin, but they could never take it out of the way. The sinner was never relieved of his guilty conscience because they were brought to their remembrance every time the lambs and the bulls and the goats and the birds, every time they would be offered, there was a constant reminder. And so Jesus makes that one time, that unique, unrepeatable sacrifice once for all time to satisfy ultimately the requirement of God to atone for man's sin. What man could not do, God did. Jesus did. And it was purposeful. Look at what Peter says. The reason Jesus died was to bring us to God. You see, that's the message of reconciliation. Isaiah tells us in Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, Isaiah asks the question, is the arm of the Lord so short that he cannot heal? Is the ear of the Lord so dull that it cannot hear? And then Isaiah answers those questions and he says, no, it's not God's problem. It's not God's fault. He says, your sin has separated you from God. Your iniquities have caused him not to hear. And it has brought that separation, so much so that there's this gulf that exists between man and God. And it really doesn't have to be that wide. It could be as narrow as this aisle right here. It could be as wide as the Grand Canyon. It doesn't matter. If God is on one side and I'm on the other side and we're separated, that's a problem. And it doesn't matter by how much we're separated. And so the purpose was to bring us back to God. It was to build that bridge. It was to make reconciliation, to reconcile a lost relationship with the one who breathed into us the breath of life and the one who spoke the worlds into existence. It was something that we could not do on our own. And so Jesus accomplished that for us because Christ died for those sins in that gulf that separate us. And so if you're looking at this gulf that exists between man and God, the blood of Jesus has covered it and enables us to be reconciled. Oh, isn't that the beauty of the Lamb's death? But then, this is an interesting passage. It's probably, perhaps, arguably, is there enough qualifying words there? The most difficult passage in Scripture. At least one of, when we look at the Lamb's proclamation. Because it says that when he died, he was made alive in the Spirit, and he went and made proclamation to the spirits now in prison who once were disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah during the construction of the ark in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through the water. So what's Jesus doing? Well, it's helpful to look at what the text says because this is a difficult passage. And I'm not going to go into all of the different explanations. There are no less than five major interpretations of this text. And undoubtedly, there are innumerable more thoughts and ideas on the passage. But I want you to notice something, that when Peter makes this statement, he doesn't give us the sermon notes. He doesn't give us an outline. He doesn't even give us the content of the proclamation. He just says that he went and made proclamation. So what does the text say about Jesus? Well, first of all, it says he was put to death, but he was made alive in the Spirit. Second of all, it says that he went and made proclamation. Again, no details are given. He went and made proclamation, evidently in the Spirit. What does the text say about his audience? These are spirits who are now in prison. That's what the text says. The text tells us that these spirits were disobedient in the days of Noah. During the construction of the ark, when the patience of God kept waiting. What does the text say about Noah then? If this is in the days of Noah and Noah is building the ark, what does it say about Noah? Well, one of the things that it says, Noah was among a very few people, a very, very small group of people compared to the immensity of humanity. Eight persons were in that ark. And Noah was one of those eight persons who was brought safely through water. So without going into a whole theological discourse on the text and digging through all of the Greek language, you guys want to do that? We could do that in a Bible class sometime. It's really fascinating. But let me tell you what the text cannot mean. Okay? Because this is one of the popular views that are out there, that Jesus, he went between the time when he died and the time that he was raised from the dead and the tomb was found empty, that Jesus had gone and preached to the people who had died under the old covenant period to preach the gospel to them, that they might respond to the gospel, that they might repent, and that they might yet be saved. It cannot mean that. It cannot mean that Jesus preached the gospel to people who had already gone to hell and gave them a second chance. Now, how do we know that? Luke chapter 16 and verse 26. In Luke chapter 16, Jesus talks about this rich man who had all the blessings of life, and he even had a servant. Well, he probably had more than one, but one of the servants is named, and his name is Lazarus. And so this rich man died, and his soul was in torment, okay? Body was in the tomb somewhere. The soul was in torment. Well, it came time that Lazarus, his servant, would die, and his servant didn't have any of the blessings of the rich man during his life. He just ate from the crumbs that fell from his master's table. But when he died, he was taken to the bosom of Abraham, it tells us. And so from there, from that region, that what we call the place of disembodied spirits, the rich man recognized his servant in the bosom of Abraham. In other words, at the side of Abraham. And he saw him over there, but he realized that they were separated. There's that gulf again. They were separated, so he looked over, and evidently he was close enough that he could recognize Lazarus, and he could recognize Abraham. And so he called over to them. He said, Abraham, how about if you send Lazarus over here so that he could dip his finger and cool the torture that is on my tongue? It's burning with fire, you see. And it's incredibly uncomfortable. It's torture over here. And Abraham says, we can't do that. Because there is between us this chasm that is fixed. And you can't cross from there to here. And we can't cross from here to there. And so in a sense, what Abraham is explaining to this rich man is that during your lifetime, you chose your destiny. And so did Lazarus. And that's why Lazarus is here with me. And that's why you're in torment. But now that we've died, there's nothing we can do to change that. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27 says that it is appointed unto man once to die, and then comes judgment. Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13, a parable of Jesus about this wedding and the bridegroom and the attendants at the bridegroom who were to be ready when the bridegroom came. And he explains to us that the condition of death will be our condition at the final resurrection. And there is no chance. So it cannot mean that Jesus went to hell to preach the gospel to give people a second chance who had already died. So what can it mean? Notice I said, what can it mean? I didn't say what it does mean. This is a text where we cannot afford to be dogmatic. And so these are my thoughts. That in the days of Noah, the Spirit of Jesus inspired the builder of the ark while he was preaching righteousness. 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5 describes Noah as a preacher of righteousness. That gives us some insight into the content of the message that was being proclaimed, the proclamation that was being made in the days of Noah. Noah was a preacher of righteousness, and you know, the ark was under construction for 120 years. That's a long time to preach in one place. We have a hard time staying in one place for 5 or 10 years, let alone 120 years, and doing something that was so unconventional, that was so out of the box, building an ark because it was going to rain. You see, Noah's another example of one who did what was right, even when nature itself said otherwise. Because nobody had ever seen rain before. It had never rained on the earth. So when Noah was preaching to these people that God was going to destroy the earth with a flood and that it was going to rain for 40 days and 40 nights, these people refused to believe. You and I would do the same thing probably, because we've never seen it with our own eyes. We can't comprehend what that would be like. It's like living in Southern California. It's hard to comprehend rain. So Noah would build the ark against conventional wisdom. He would do what was right. And as he was preaching, the people of his day refused to obey. The people were obdurate. They would not be persuaded. They would not listen. They would only laugh and mock. And then they would die. I can imagine the crowds that were pounding on the door of the ark when they first felt that drop of rain. When, as the text tells us in Genesis chapter 6, when the earth burst forth the water. Water was coming in all directions. It was coming up from below. It was coming down from above. And I can imagine the people that were clamoring at the door of the ark to get in. And it was too late. It was too late. And they all perished. And now they're in prison. Just like the rich man with the servant Lazarus. And so consequently, 8 persons were brought safely through the water. They were saved through water. And that's what the Lamb's resurrection does for us. Saves us through water, just like he saved Noah. Our appeal is made in water. The resurrection of Jesus provides us with a great deal of hope, a great deal of guidance. He tells us that it is through the resurrection that we make an appeal to God. It's on the basis of Christ's resurrection from the grave. It's on the basis of the Lamb's victory over death that we appeal to God for a good conscience that is dead because of sin. He tells us that it is in the waters of baptism where that appeal is made. In Acts chapter 22 and verse 16, we see this appeal being made by the Apostle Paul. And as Paul was on the road to Damascus, you know, he was blinded. He was confronted by the Lord himself. They had this discussion, and he told him what he was going to do. And he said, you will go into this city named Damascus, and there will be a man named Ananias who will tell you what you must do. And when he got there, Ananias would tell him, Acts 22 and verse 16, what are you waiting for? Now this was after Paul had been relieved of all of the infirmities that he encountered on the way. He was blinded for 3 days. Scales covered his eyes. And so the text tells us that something like scales fell from his eyes. He was given his sight back. He understood who Jesus is. And Ananias says, well then, what are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. That's where Paul would make his appeal to God, to wash away his sins. If he would get up and be baptized, he could appeal to God to wash away his sins. That would cleanse his conscience. The conscience is cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. We sing about that often, don't we? The precious blood of the Lamb. And so the conscience is cleansed through the Lamb's blood. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 14, Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22, if the blood of bulls and goats could have taken away sin, there would be no need for this Lamb to give his life, because we'd just keep going on offering animals. But it says that the blood of Jesus is what cleanses our conscience from our sin. And if the blood, follow me on this, if the blood of Jesus cleanses our conscience from sin, and baptism is an appeal to God for a good conscience, then it is in the waters of baptism where we're covered by the blood of Christ. Do you see that? Do you see how easy it is when we put pieces together and understand what the Bible says? There's a new life that is given by the resurrection of the Lamb. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4 tells us that we died with Christ and we're buried with him in baptism. We've been buried into his death in baptism, so that as Jesus was raised by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. And so he pictures this death, this burial, and this resurrection of Jesus and says that's the picture of our baptism. That's what our baptism is all about. It is that we died to sin and we died to ourselves as we enter into this water. There's water right behind this screen. And as we enter into that water, as we're standing there and as somebody's talking and waiting, we recognize that we are dead. And then there is one who will put us underwater. And we are buried with him through baptism. That's Romans 6, 3 and 4. And just as Christ was raised by the glory of the Father, so we too are raised to walk in newness of life. And there is the picture of us coming up out of the water to walk in newness of life with a cleansed conscience because sin has been forgiven. We're no longer dead, but alive. That's what Paul would say to the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. You were dead in your transgressions and sins, but he made us alive together with Christ Jesus. That's the beauty of the Lamb's resurrection. So when he says that it's not the removal of dirt from the flesh, that it is an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's the resurrection of the Lamb that makes possible our own new life. And corresponding to the water through which Noah and his family were saved, we have water by which we're saved. It is through baptism, Peter says. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you also. I am amazed at all of the people who go to great efforts to explain away the simple instruction of this text. To explain away what it means to do what is right. Doing what is right is what Jesus always did. That's the Lamb of God. That's the sacrifice for sin. It requires, listen, doing the right thing requires a resolve to always be pleasing to God. Regardless of what it does to me, regardless of what other people think, regardless of what I've done in the past, regardless of previously held beliefs that I've had, doing what is right will always have that resolve to please God and to please God's purpose. But it also does require a great deal of humility. It takes a great deal of humility to recognize how dead we are and how sin kills us, how we're kept in its bondage. And so this morning we need to think about who Jesus is. We need to think about what Jesus has done as the Lamb. How this Lamb died once for all.
how this lamb made proclamation. Presumably the proclamation of righteousness and the lamb's resurrection that gives us hope and gives us life. Think about who Jesus is. Think about what he's done. Think about what he asks. Jesus said in Mark chapter 16 and verse 16, "He who believes and has been baptized shall be saved. He who doesn't believe is condemned already." Do you know who Jesus is? Do you know what he's done? Do you know what he asks of you? Now is the time to respond. Maybe you need to make that appeal to God for a good conscience. Maybe you need to be baptized into Christ, that your sins would be forgiven, that you'd be raised to walk in newness of life, and that your conscience would be completely clear of the entire life you've lived to this point. Everything that you have done to create a gulf, a chasm between you and God. And today is the day to be immersed in that water. Now, maybe you've been a Christian for a long time and just haven't been living life in all of its newness. Maybe you've stumbled and struggled along the way. Probably everybody in the room has done that a time or two. And maybe it's time to get back into the new life that we've been called to live. You have needs this morning. We all have needs. The beauty about the church gathering is that we're here to meet those needs. We're going to stand and we're going to sing. And if you'd express those needs to us, we'd love to pray with you. We'd love to study with you. We'd love to baptize you. Whatever your need is, would you let us know right now as we stand and sing?
Just as